All right. Well, I don't promise to do any martial arts. I will, in fact, talk about the principles of visualization. So let me start out with a definition. If we're going to talk about what the principles are, let's say what it is that we are discussing. And my own current definition is computer-based visualization systems provide visual representations of data sets intended to help people carry out some task more effectively. So what are some of the implications of that statement? Well, one is there's data and there's people and there is some connection between them. So there is some human in the loop who needs the details about a data set. Now, you might ask, well, when do we need a human in the loop? It's when we either don't know enough to completely automate a system, or maybe we have a hypothetical way to automate that we have to validate before we go deploying it. And when do people need to see the details? Well, when the summary statistics alone don't tell you the full picture. So this is one of our favorite examples in visualization. It's Anscombe's quartet, which is four data sets specifically designed to have identical statistical properties up to and including the mean, the variance in both X and in Y, the correlation. You can see barely there's a linear regression line that's identical for all four. So you get a sense that they're all the same. But by looking at a picture, of course, you see, once you see the full distribution, you can see, oh, in one case it's a weak correlation, in another case it's not even linear, one there's an outlier, and then the other there's an outlier and almost a pessimal distribution to try to confuse you about what's really going on with that data set. So although this is a caricature, a tiny data set with 20 dots in it, what I want you to think of is what are situations in the real world where humans do need to know the rich characteristics of the distribution of the data set. Another aspect of this is we've got a visual representation. So what does that mean? It means we have chosen to have an external representation. So what we're trying to do is, whenever possible, swap in perception for internal resources of cognition and memory. So in contrast to that picture on the left, where we see a lot of dots, this picture on the right has a bunch of numbers. These happen to be microarray measurements for genes. And it's very difficult to immediately look at this and get the min, the max, characterize the trends, and that's because it is a cognitive act to read the numbers, store them in your mind, do internal comparisons. Instead, you want your visual system to do that for you, thus harnessing perception. Now, notice how there's the word task in my definition. That means there is some intended task. If all you have is data, that is not enough. You have to know what it is that you are drawing the picture to help people do. That intended task might be explicitly articulated really clearly, or it might be more implicitly assumed, but it is in there. And finally, I said more effectively, and any time you use the word more, you have to say more compared to what. So there must be some measurable definitions of what we mean to be effective, and I'll be talking about some of that as the talk continues. So does it mean faster, easier, more correct, novel capabilities, all of the above? So there is a huge space of alternatives in the design space of visualization design. So think about all the ways you might design a visualization. That's a ginormous space. Trade-offs abound. So of course, it's not just that you can completely optimize for everything you want. There's a trade-off here. Now, the good and the bad news is we know a priori that many possibilities in that design space are ineffective. They do not do their job. They mislead and confuse rather than enlighten and help. So what you want to do is avoid a random walk through the parameter space of design possibilities. It will take a long time to get it right. In fact, if you think about it in the language of computer science algorithms, it is literally an exponential space. So what I am hoping I can convince you to do is to avoid some of the past mistakes of the InfoViz community, because we had a youthful enthusiasm phase where we tried a lot of things and it turns out only some of them worked. And we've done a lot of experiments to discover what works and what doesn't. So we were seduced by some things that perhaps you can guide yourself around. Now, these guidelines are not set in stone. They are most certainly continuing to evolve. One of the things we do in the Viz community to try to help get these guidelines to continue is to reflect on what we know, to do a design study where we explain in detail what's the problem we are trying to solve, and then discuss whether our proposed solution really actually did nail that, or whether there's something we learned that we didn't know, and we can incorporate that back into the space of design guidelines. So even for people that are quite aware of a lot of the currently known trade-offs, there's still a lot of refining to do. It's rare that we totally nail it on the very first try. Usually we end up doing some kind of iterative refinement where you build a system and then you watch the people use it. Sometimes you curse to yourself if you see they didn't quite do what you had in mind, but we do not just blame the user, we actually then go back and make the system better. So I've picked 7 principles to talk about today. There are, of course, more, but these are the ones we're going to discuss, at least from my point of view, about knowing what visual channels are, the constraints of how many colors you can show at once, the power of planar position and the danger of 3D depth, why resolution typically beats immersion, why the eyes beat memory, and the concept of validate against the right threat, not the wrong threat. So let me start out with this idea of types. So before we talk visual channel types, we have to start out with some basics on data types. So here I've got a little taxonomy of data. So let's start with, I've got a spreadsheet and there's stuff in it. What might be in that data table? What might be the columns of my spreadsheet? If I think about the rows as being some kind of points or items, what could be in a column? Well, it might be categorical attributes. My example for this is fruit. You can be apples, you can be oranges, you can be bananas. Happily, we just had fruit up there, which made me very happy. The point about categorical data is you can know you are in a category or you are out of a category. So there is no implicit ordering. There are ways you could impose orderings on categorical, non-ordered data. But a priori, from the data's point of view, it's just categories, so in or out, as opposed to ordered data. Now, once we have ordered data, well, we can actually continue on and we can say, well, there's some ordering in the data. In one example, with ordinal data, all we have is ordering. So t-shirt sizes are a great example. There are small shirts and medium and large shirts. Everyone knows that medium shirts are in between small and large. But we do not ask the question of what is a large t-shirt minus a small t-shirt, undefined. That has no meaning. So there is order, but you can't do full-on arithmetic with ordinal data. The data type where you can is quantitative data. So that's what you normally think of as this is numerical data. You can do full-on arithmetic. So you can ask questions like, if you've made a length measurement, what's 23 inches minus 17 inches? That is a meaningful number. So for tabular data now, we've talked about basically do you have unordered or ordered or full on quantitative data. What else is there? Well, for one thing, we might say, well, what if, going back to our spreadsheet metaphor, we want to somehow talk about links between the columns of this data. Then we want to think about relational data. So not just the individual columns, but how could we express some kind of linkage between items? So let's call that relational. And then finally, in contrast to everything else I just talked about, there is true spatial data. So this is data that actually is intrinsically about position, whether that's geographic latitudes and longitudes, or three-dimensional positions in space like you would get with an MRI scan. So the key thing is, I'm often going to talk about spatial as opposed to abstract. So here I'm using abstract to mean non-spatial data. All right. So having talked about data types, now let me leap into visual encoding. So here I'm showing you 4 different pictures, and I'd like to say, okay, let us analyze these pictures in terms of how we are showing some kind of abstract data dimension. So we've got data like I just talked about with data types. How many of these abstract dimensions could we actually encode in the picture? So we can stare at this a while. There might be a lot of ways we could think about this. I'm going to have us start to think about analyzing this as a combination of what I'll call marks and channels. So let's talk about what those are. So in what's called image theory, which grew out of the work of French semiotician Bertin in the 60s and has been continually refined since then, there's this idea that there's a mark you could make, a geometric primitive. So the zero-dimensional case is a point, the one-dimensional case is a line, the two-dimensional case is an area. So given these geometric primitives, what can we do to them to control their appearance? That's what we're going to call visual channels. So this could be things like the spatial position of the marks, either horizontally or vertically or both for a planar spatial position. It could be things like color or the orientation or tilt, the size, whether it's area or volume, shape. So there's a lot of, this is not even a complete list, this is just a few of them. So once we have this vocabulary of a mark, which is a geometric primitive, and channels which control their appearance, now we can go back and think about how it is that we can analyze these visual encodings using marks and channels. So, of course, what we've got on the left is a bar graph. Breaking that down, we're using the mark type of a line, and we're encoding one abstract data dimension using the visual channel of vertical position. Once we move to a scatter plot, we've switched to a point mark, and now we're using both vertical and horizontal spatial condition to encode two abstract data dimensions. We can add color to that, so that's using a third abstract dimension and adding the visual channel of color. And then here we've added one more visual channel of size, and now we're encoding four abstract dimensions. So there's a bunch of questions you might start to ask. How did we decide to use these particular visual channels? How many visual channels are there? What kinds of information can they convey? How much information can they convey? Are some better than others? Can we use them independently, or do they ever stomp on each other? So let's think about these. So the fundamental breakdown with visual channels is, what's the type? This is actually built into our perceptual systems. How do we interpret information we see with these channels? And one set of channels is what we can call the what or the where channels. So with these what, where channels, these are things like, well, clearly planar position is not surprisingly going to be a where. That says where is something. And the rest of these channels, like the hue for the color, so you'd say, what color is it? Is it red? Is it blue? Is it yellow? Is it purple? You can say, what shape is that, a circle or a square? You can say, what's the pattern? Is it a dashed line or a dotted line? More generally, let's call that the stipple pattern, if we think not just about lines, but areas. So these are the visual channels that we intrinsically interpret as telling us what something is. In contrast, there are other visual channels, in fact, pretty much all the rest of them, that don't tell us what something is. They tell us how much of something. So we're also seeing things like position, either along a common scale or an unaligned scale. And so position can tell us, you know, what place is this in? Sorry, how much of something there is. Is this length longer or shorter than another? So we have length. We have things like how much tilt does something have? How large is the angle? So how much is the size of something? So there's area, curvature, volume, things like, notice how I've actually separated out color here. I've separated out this, what I'll technically call hue, which is it purple or red or blue, from grayscale lightness. So that's, sorry, my gray's a little washed out here, but you can think of it as luminance contrast. Gray is always in between black and white. Color saturation, so pink is in between, again, sorry for the washout, pink is in between red and white. So we're separating out luminance, saturation, color saturation from hue. Notice how the luminance and the saturation are how much, whereas the hue is a what. Things like stipple density. So first of all, there's the what versus the how much. Now, this should make you think of something. We just saw data taxonomy, where we had categorical data that's very well suited for these what channels. And in contrast, if you have ordered data, whether it's ordinal or quantitative, and you need to express that ordering intrinsically with the perceptual system, you would like that to be one of these how much ordered channels. Otherwise, if you start flipping in between, you'll start either to express something that's not in the data, or there's something in the data that you don't even have the ability to express. So you want to be really careful not to imply ordering that doesn't exist and to be able to show it where it does. Now, there's another thing we'd like to do, again, with the perceptual system, which is show some idea of something's in a group, so some kind of grouping. And there are a lot of ways to show grouping, for example, enclosure or containment, where we're actually surrounding things in an area, connection in one dimension, so literally drawing a line between things. That's, of course, a fundamental way we show networks. In general, there's similarity. In fact, using any of these other channels, even channels like motion. You heard a bit about the Gestalt principles. So common fate is the similar motion. There's also similar color. And then, of course, there's proximity, which is things that are close together. You intrinsically, with your visual system, consider to be grouped together. So when might we use grouping? Well, two situations here. One is if we have relational data. We want to show relationship between things. The other is if we have categorical data and we want to show that things are in the same category. So a lot of information on this slide. Let me talk about a few of the implications. One is the power of the plane, which is notice how spatial position is actually on every single one of these lists. That is the only thing that is on every single one of these lists. So there is a lot of power to using spatial position to communicate data because it works for everything. Now, another thing you should notice is, except for spatial position, we have a pretty much disjoint set of things. So the ranking of how good something is depends on what this data type is. So I actually have chosen a specific order of these, which is a ranking for how good they are. This was not an arbitrarily chosen order. I'm actually asserting that things near the top of the list, in the case of categorical and quantitative, are actually better than things near the bottom of the list. I'm also asserting with the grouping list that in terms of what overrides, so it turns out if you've got both connection and proximity, that in some sense you can have connection override the proximity queue. They all work, but some have the ability to override the other. So, and this fundamental idea that you want to be careful that if ordering is in your data, you can express it, there's a lot of implications for that. I don't have time to get into all of them today, but just to pick one, notice how we don't have changes of hue here for ordered data. This is one of the reasons that visualization people often get upset when people use rainbow color maps to try to show ordered or quantitative data, because intrinsically your perceptual system doesn't interpret changes of hue as having an intrinsic order. Saturation, yes. Luminance, yes, but not hue. So there's a lot of implications of these rankings, and I'll only get to talk about some of them today. But you might have a question, which is, where did I get these from? Did I make them up? Did I grab them out of a hat? So I've just asserted rankings for these. What's the evidence? So there's a principle. The effect of this principle that was in what I call one of the original papers that started the field of information visualization by Geoff McKinley, which is that you should encode the most important attributes at the highest ranked channels. Now, I'll be talking later on in the talk about how in heck you would figure out, well, what's the important stuff. But for the moment, let's focus on this question of ranking channels. So there are some ways we can come up with these channel rankings. Our ability to accurately perceive things. How many steps can we discriminate? Are channels separable or integral? And which things actually pop out at us with pre-attentive processing? So let's go through these. So first and fundamentally, this question of accuracy. What does your visual system do with input that comes to it? So one of the crowning achievements of psychophysics, which is the science of measuring sensation from the 20th century, was the work of Stevens, who came up with a huge body of evidence that our ability to perceive sensory input in all of the sensory modalities is a power law. And what changes between modality is the exponent of the power law. So some things like electric current applied to your fingertips are magnified. If you double that current, you perceive more than double the tingle in your fingertips. So it's also true with color saturation and, in fact, black and white lightness. These are all magnified. There's one thing that's really important on this diagram, which is that length is exactly linear. The exponent here is 1.0. So we have very, very accurate perceptions of length compared to these other modalities. And then some things like area and loudness and brightness are actually compressed. So you double the physical sensation and you get less than double the response. So Stevens actually measured things through all modalities. I've just included loudness here as a reference. I'm focusing here on the visual ones, not things like touch and smell and taste and so on, which he also studied. So Stevens' law is one interesting and useful bunch of information. What else? Well, a lot of people have actually done direct experiments that are trying to say, okay, how do these visual channels actually work when we encode abstract data and then run a bunch of measured response experimental tests with humans? So for example, I mentioned that position along a common scale was the most accurate thing we can perceive. Why is that? Well, let's actually look. This is something that Stevens, let's see if I can get my mouse. No. Laser? Yes. All right. So if I just tell you, compare these two rectangles, is one of them longer than the other? That's actually a very hard perceptual task. If I enclose them in a common frame or I align them against a common beginning spot, it's pretty easy. Why? Well, one of the reasons that we can use to explain this phenomenon, which Cleveland pointed out in a landmark paper in 1984, is this is just an application of Weber's law, another one of these basic psychophysical laws, which is that our visual system actually doesn't do absolute measurement. What it does is relative judgment. Everything is relative. So specifically, Weber's law is the ratio of what the increment is to the background. That is constant. So what that really means is we make relative judgments. And specifically, the length difference between the filled rectangles is only 1 part in 9. That's hard. But the length difference between the white rectangles that are made between the end of the blue and that common frame, well, that's actually 1 to 2. That's easy. So this is an easy perceptual judgment. This is a hard perceptual judgment. Framing things allows us to basically everything up to the 50% mark will judge with the dark rectangle, and then everything above the 50% mark from 50 to 100% will judge with the other rectangle. So it basically gives us a lot more precision. But there's other things. It's not just about the accuracy of our perception. What about things like having an impedance match between what we want to show and what the channel can show? So we'll generally think of this as how discriminable is the channel. That is, how many usable steps are there? So let's think about this example. A lot of people use this for line width. This is actually telecommunications network bandwidth from several years ago. And I like this because it makes it clear that while line width can be a very, very powerful visual channel and effective, there are a limited number of steps that we can use. Because, of course, if you make lines too wide, they're not lines anymore. They're polygons. They're areas. So there's this kind of built-in cap on how fat you can make a line before you don't perceive it as a line. So there are limits to the number of usable steps with line width. Now, the gotcha for a lot of people, including some people in this community, is not knowing that there are very, very strong constraints on showing categorical colors. So I'm going to pick on Syntony in particular just because it's a perfect example. But many, many other systems have fallen into the same trap. So if you just look at this side, which is basically acting as its own legend, you can actually perceive, even with this projector, some pretty subtle differences between, for example, these greens and these blues. But it's not just about the legend. If you look over here, where they're actually being used in non-contiguous small regions, it's much, much harder. You basically can go through and say, well, OK, there's yellow, and there's green, and there's orange, and there's red, and there's, wait, we already said green. OK, here's a blue. There's a, well, OK, a cyan, a purple. So we've gotten to about 7 or 8, and we can't tell the difference anymore. So the problem is, even though we're fantastic at making really sharp distinctions between things that are right next to each other, we're actually quite bad. This comes back to our ability to perceive things as relative, not absolute. When these regions are small and scattered all around and not necessarily contiguous, we actually have a fairly limited range. So 6 to 12, 12 is the good case. And don't forget that you need a color for the background. So usually somewhere around 8 is considered safe. So that's one issue that's about discriminability. Another one, which you might not have explicitly thought about, is the question of how separable are the visual channels. So let's start with a nice case. Here we've said, OK, let's encode. We've got 2 different abstract dimensions. And we're going to try to encode them using 2 different visual channels. And we have achieved total victory, because we can either see, oh, here's the group on the left or the group on the right. Or we can say there's the black stuff and the red stuff. So we are separably able to read off that information back from the visual encoding. So we wanted to encode 2 groups, and we successfully have encoded 2 groups each. So you can separably look at either the position or the hue, and we are happy. Now we start to get not quite so happy. So in this case, what we've done is we've encoded size and hue, specifically color. Color, specifically hue. And the thing is, there's a little bit of interference here, because although we can definitely tell the big stuff from the small stuff, and for the big ones, we can tell purple from blue, with the small ones, it's much, much harder to tell them apart. And that is because of the known issue that the smaller the region of color is, the harder a time we have perceiving it. So basically, encoding with size starts to step on the toes of encoding with color. And it's not just a problem with color, it's also a problem with shape. Of course, if this thing is small enough, you don't really have enough pixels to discriminate the squares from the circles. Right? So there's this problem that once you start size coding, you're going to get some interference when you try to code some of the other channels. So we kind of have two groups each, but not exactly. Life gets more difficult when we have the bright idea that we could encode basically one abstract variable with x size, which is width, and one abstract variable with y size, which is height. And the problem is that there is significant interference because our visual system goes and treats this as an integral percept. So what you see is area, which is planar size. So you don't see two separate groups. You see big stuff, you see little stuff, and you see squished things. So you're really seeing three groups here, not two groups apiece. Because your visual system is treating this as an integral percept, you're getting three. But life can get even worse. So let's talk. This is another trap that many people have fallen into, which is, oh, in computers, color is expressed as R, G, and B channels. So what if I went and encoded three different abstract dimensions in red, green, and blue? Well, let's just consider the slightly less ambitious case of using the red channel and the green channel. I carefully went through and made this picture. There is low red. There is high red. There is low green. There is high green. Tough. You do not see that. What you see is four groups because your visual system has got the integral percept of hue. So you are seeing four different groups. Now, is this good or bad? It depends on what your goals are. So if your goal is separable encoding of two different abstract dimensions, then it's safer to use the separable channels. If your goal is to actually deliberately want something like the four groups or the three groups that you get from the integral percept, then of course you should deliberately use the integral pairs, not the separable pairs. So it's not that it's good or bad, it's that you have to make sure it is matched with your goals. All right, now there's this fantastic visual phenomenon of pop-out, which is that your visual system is literally doing massive parallel processing without your conscious attention. So I'm sure you've all noticed there is a red dot in that picture, and you noticed it fast. But the cool thing is, you would have noticed it almost just as fast if instead of 20 dots, I had 1,000 distractor blue dots. Because if something's sufficiently different, it jumps out at you independent of the distractor count. It is literally a parallel process. So, and it's not just color. It's orientation, it's size, it's grayscale lightness, shape, proximity, elongation, curvature, even relatively subtle things like lighting direction. So there's a lot of these visual channels where we get this pop-out effect. Now, there are things that do not pop out. There are ways you could imagine visually encoding information where you don't have pop-out, and parallelism is the classic example. So eventually, if I tell you to look for parallel lines, you're going to find that there's a pair of lines that is parallel, but they don't jump out at you as the very slightly tilted ones jumping out from that set of slightly tilted. You don't get that for free. You can get it, but it basically requires serial search, and so the number of distractors matters, and as there's more distractors, it takes you longer. So you might think, fantastic, we have this built-in parallel processing, so maybe I could go off and take 8 abstract data dimensions, and as long as they're all separable, I can then have pop-out 8 different ways till Sunday, and then I can go home and declare victory. Again, it is not quite that simple. So the sad truth is basically you only get to do it on one channel. So if I tell you, look for the red dot, but the distractor set is red and blue dots and squares, we're back down to serial search. So the technical term for this is conjunctive search. There's a few special cases where there's some pairs where you can pull it off, but in general, you can't even do it for two, much less three or more. So you basically only get to spend it in one place. So you get one channel. And even within the channel, I mentioned that things like it's not just color, it's color and shape and stuff. It probably actually took you longer to find the red dot in this picture. And that's because the difference in shape between dots and squares is less extreme than the difference in color between the reds and the blues. So it has to do with the context of what the distractors are, of what the meaning of sufficiently different to pop out is. So it's not just whether it pops out, but how long it takes to pop out. there's a huge amount of research in this area coming directly out of cognitive psychology and continuing on with some of the Viz community. So there's a lot more to talk about there. But moving along to an actual example, so let's think about what all these principles might mean for visually encoding biological data. So we've heard a lot about heat maps and how at the end of the day it all comes back down to heat maps. And let's think about what we just learned, which is that even though color is a traditional thing, we know that spatial position actually outranks that in terms of accuracy. So while you could show data with a heat map, what would happen if you tried to show data with spatial position instead? So let's actually take a look at this. And the fundamental idea is you can express data as a series of colored boxes where you have taken a quantitative variable and encoded it with color, but you're probably going to get better perception of the shape of something if you actually use a filled framed line chart. It's maybe a little bit hard to see the fill with this projector, but we can definitely see that it's a line chart. So the idea here is you do get some sense of what's happening from the colored boxes, but the details of shape, especially concepts like, well, is something shifted over compared to one shape to another, you have a much easier time seeing that when you're looking at these curves than when you're looking at the heat maps. So this is something we proposed in a paper on a tool called Pathline. Those of you who were here last year might have heard a bit about it when Bang Wong spoke. But it's an example of using a different principle of, let's try to say, well, what should we be using spatial position for? We want to use it for the most important thing we're trying to show in general, because we have such high definition of perceptual accuracy with that. Okay, so another principle I promised to talk about is the dangers of depth. Now, you might have noticed I kept talking about planar spatial position and the power of the plane. The reason I emphasize this is that all of those rankings about spatial position are only for the plane. They do not include three-dimensional depth. So a lot of people are somewhat seduced by the idea that since we live in 3D, 2D good, 3D better, in the animal farm sense of the word. But the thing is, we don't really live in 3D. What we see is in Colin Ware's fantastic phrase, 2.05. dimensions. So what do I mean by that? Well, if you think about what you see, you get up and down and you get sideways. If you think about some kind of image plane in front of you. And the thing is, how do you see more information? You just move your eyes. That's something we do incredibly fast on the millisecond level. A lot of that's not even conscious. Very, very fast perception of things on the image plane by these eye motions called saccades. If I want to see into the scene with depth, I actually have to move, right? I have to move my head, or I have to, worse yet, move my whole body. So if you look at my little caricature here, right, you've got this person. They're seeing the red cube. They're seeing the green cube. They can't see the blue thing. And moreover, eye motions alone will not show them the blue thing. They actually have to move their point of view so that there's no longer an occlusion problem with the blue thing being blocked. So there's a lot of really nice exposition by Colin Ware in his latest book, Visual Thinking for Design, if you want to think more about the implications of this 2.05 dimensional world. So what's so bad about 3D? Let's go through the list. So the fundamental problem is occlusion. That's the big word for some stuff is in front of other stuff. When you are visually encoding abstract information, that means it's in the way and you can't see things. This is bad. And you might say, oh, well, okay, yeah, here's an example of this 3D graph, and okay, you can't really see everything, but you can spin it around. And through interaction, it will save the day. But the problem is interaction has complexity. You are actually using internal cognitive resources to remember what you saw before as you spin the thing around to try to integrate all those different views into your head and get some sense of the 3D spatial structure. So it adds complexity, which typically means it makes things take longer to understand the 3D data. But that's not all. So perspective distortion is a huge problem. You might think perspective, that's great. In the Renaissance, they finally invented perspective, and now they draw beautiful pictures, and Leonardo did it, and we love perspective, right? Not with abstract information. We actually hate perspective. And the problem is that it interferes with all of that size channel encodings. So let's consider this slightly ill-conceived thing from the 1990s, where we've got a bunch of basically glyph-style icons that march off into the distance on the ground plane, you can't actually try to figure out things like height or width or depth coding for the guys much far away compared to the ones in front. So all of that fantastic power of being able to read things off with planar spatial position is gone because of perspective distortion. It's a huge problem. And just to make matters worse, you can't even read your labels. So text legibility is far, far worse when you tilt even slightly off from the image plane. These fonts have been carefully, carefully hand-designed so that every pixel works. When you suddenly go tilting them, that goes to heck. The technical term in computer graphics is aliasing. Very, very poor legibility consequences. Again, this is an example from the 90s. There's some very nice studies that were done by Grossman and Balakrishnan recently about exactly what's going on with orientation on text legibility. So let's look at an example. So this is from the What Not to Do figure of a paper by Van Wyk and Bonsalo. And they have a series of time series curves. So basically, the vertical axis is the amount of power consumed in a building. And then we've got the hours in the day. And they've got this time series over the course of an entire year. So they say, well, what happens if we do the obvious thing and we extrude it in 3D? Because after all, 3D is fabulous, right? And the problem is, well, it's not so fabulous. You can see really large-scale patterns like, well, OK, late at night, they're not in the building. And during the day, they are. And we even use less energy in the summer than in the winter. But if I ask you, look at this picture, tell me, when did we use more power? 10 a.m. on February 14th or 4 p.m. on November 19th? You are doomed. You cannot read the answer off of this picture. In contrast, what they actually do is say, let's think about what we're really trying to do. Let us transform our data into the right abstraction, and then draw a picture of the thing which would help you actually solve your problem. So they said, well, we just got a completely unordered collection of time series curves, but let's do a transformation on it. Let us get derived data, and in this case, it was let's run a clustering. And now we can pick just a few of the highly ranked clusters, if we're just doing simple hierarchical clustering or something agglomerative, and we can draw those, and we can actually look in detail and make comparisons at any time of day to see what's actually happening. And then they say, well, what visual representation is really good for showing temporal patterns? That would be calendars. And the key thing is there's a linkage between these two views in the form of color, where you can see that a curve of a particular color, what days are the curves in that cluster. And you can immediately start to see much more subtle patterns, not just of things like weekends versus weekdays and summer versus winter, but a lot of interesting things where you can figure out, well, when were their holidays, including really bizarre Dutch holidays where everyone gets to go home an hour early on December because it's called Santa Claus Day. I kid you not. You would not have found Santa Claus Day in that other view. So basically, the thing is, I'm not saying you never get to use 3D. You get to use 3D exactly when they need 3D. And typically, they don't usually need 3D unless some of the data that they've got is intrinsically three-dimensional spatial data. And in those cases, often the task requires that they understand the structure of that data. And then you go ahead and say, yes, there are costs, but the benefit is worth it. And we go ahead and use 3D. You really, really want to be careful about justifying 3D when your data is non-spatial abstract data. So as a field, we were wildly enthusiastic about this in the 90s. And then the glow kind of wore off. And there is now considerable skepticism about you have to justify, particularly in the absolute worst case of point clouds, or the almost worst case of networks, where depth perception is a particular problem. So here's one of the many papers. This one's actually from the tail end of the 90s, where we've got, you know, these 3D networks in space. It's very hard to actually understand what's going on here. And, you know, texture mapping little pictures on the cubes does not help. So you do want to be careful to only use three dimensions when you really need it. And there's actually kind of a corollary to that, which is this idea of resolution beating out immersion. So immersion, which is the sense of presence you get in synthetic virtual environments, is only useful for some kinds of tasks. Right? So when do you need a sense of presence that you're really immersed in the space? When do you actually need stereoscopic 3D and all kinds of fancy displays. The thing is, when you've got abstract data, you often don't need immersion. And there's a price you pay for immersion. Basically, it's been true for a number of years, and it probably will be for much longer, that anytime you have to pick between immersive 3D stereoscopic displays and your standard desktop monitor, you get more pixels on the standard desktop monitor. And the thing is, pixels are the scarcest resource you have. Pixels is the first thing we run out of. So concepts like information density, it comes down to almost all of InfoViz is a bunch of techniques designed to help you around the problem that you instantly run out of pixels, and the only way you can show them the data that they need is to then carefully change the view so that they actually have some hope of seeing more. So pixels are precious, precious things. You typically want to have as many as you can. And there's another problem as well, which is workflow integration. So if you have to, A, go down the hall, in the best case, or to another building, and use this system, and either you've got a head-mounted display or you're in some kind of cave with rear projection thing, so you're standing there, you're not on your own laptop. How do you actually bring up the web browser to go look at things in PubMed or check your email as you're in this immersive 3D thing? You're standing up often, so you're tired, right? So there are a lot of issues why you wouldn't be working 8 hours a day in one of these immersive environments. So while there were a few somewhat abortive attempts to try to do InfoViz in these VR systems, I strongly counsel you that you want to be even more careful to justify immersion, again, when you have abstract data. So I'm happy that the previous speaker showed that video clip of the 3D immersive environment, because I think it's a good setup for you to think about, it was great science fiction, but you always want to be careful not to treat science fiction as a spec. That's another problem that the visualization community ran into a bit during the design of VRML, the virtual reality modeling language, where Snow Crash was fantastic, but it's a novel, it's not a specification. In particular, speed of light, latency. They did not think about how to do short bytes. Moving on. So, another principle, eyes beat memory. This comes back to the idea that whenever possible, we want to use external cognition rather than internal memory. So it's always easy to compare by moving your eyes. This gets back to that principle of quick saccades. It's harder to compare what you saw before, which is a memory in your head, to what you are seeing now. So there's a bunch of implications, which again might conflict with some of your intuition. So a lot of people have the intuition that animation is great, because after all, animation is an incredibly powerful storytelling medium. After all, I went to see all these movies by Disney and Pixar, and they were fantastic. But there was somebody behind the scenes, the choreographer, who went to great lengths to make sure that only one thing was happening at once and your eyes were looking at the right spot on the screen. For those who are interested, there's a great talk by John, or a paper by Lasseter who talks about this. That takes work, and it's typically not the case with abstract data. So while we found in visualization, and there's a lot of papers backing up the idea, that if you have two states with relatively small changes between, it's a great transition. So animated transitions instead of jump cuts are great. But if you've got a multi-frame, so lots and lots of states with changes everywhere, maybe there are better ways to do it. So just to dive a bit into the land of techniques, there's techniques called small multiples, where instead of being very literal and saying, I've got data that's changing over time, so surely I should show change over time with change over time, there's an abstract way to think about it, which is, well, I'll show change over time with space. So as an example, you guys have seen a bit of this since it's on the program, but the example is from the system called Cerebral, where this idea of small multiples is same visual encoding, but we're looking at slightly different examples of the data. So in this case, what we've got is the same spatial layout. We've got some gene expression data, which we're encoding as color, but we have the same spatial layout of the protein-gene interaction graph underneath that. So each one of these small multiples has a different color coding showing these different experimental conditions. These actually happen to be time series data. So there is change over time here in the underlying data. So you might say, well, is this really so much better than the animation? Now, the problem with the animation is if you just focus on one of these, okay, white, yellow, green, white, I've completely lost track of what was happening anywhere else. So I can focus on any particular small region, but it's very, very hard to remember what's happening in the larger frame. So global comparison is difficult when you have multi-frame complex changes. So animation can sometimes have power, but probably a lot less often than you think. For those who want to know more, there's this fantastic meta review by Barbara Tversky, where she shows that in almost every study that found good effects for animation, they were not comparing apples to apples. They were comparing animations that had a lot more information to stills. And she found that if you carefully choose the segmentation, small multiples beat animations. So I've been really focused on this question about visual encoding and interaction, but actually, there's a lot more to life. So there are three more levels of, that's interesting. I think the green channel's out on this projector, since we're not seeing the green or the blue. Actually, I think there's a few channels out. Anyway, these would be four different colors, but they're not. Use your imaginations. So there are three more levels of design questions in addition to visual encoding. And there are different threats to validity at each level. And it is critical that you validate against the right threat. So what do I mean by these threats? Well, one is you got the wrong problem. You misunderstood the needs of the user, so you're solving a non-problem. Or you've picked the wrong abstraction, so what you show them is the wrong thing. Or what we've been really focused on in this talk is encoding. The way you show it doesn't work given how perceptual systems work. Or finally, your algorithm's bad and your code is too slow. These are four very different levels of design. And what you want to do is really focus on the four separately. So the problem level, where you want to identify a problem amenable to visualization, that is, maybe you think visualization could either help you do something new, or actually the more common cases, speed something up that you're already doing. So what are some ways you can get that right? Well, one is run out and actually talk to people. Turns out that we know from methodology out of human-computer interaction and ethnography that talking to people is necessary but not sufficient. Then you have to actually go watch what they do, because typically they're not introspecting in the way you need them to. And then a downstream signal is, well, if you go off and you build it and you deploy it, is anyone using this? It's a noisy signal. There's some great systems that are not used. There's some horrible systems that are widely used, as we've heard from people muttering about Excel. But it is still useful to know, has anyone but the developer of the system ever used it? Versus people are actually running around using that are the intended target users. Then there's this abstraction phase. And this is a really, really important phase that I want to make sure everyone thinks about, because it's common for non-visualization people to completely skip over this step. So what makes visualization interesting is that we go from the domain specific to the generic. So financial analysts, should I buy or sell the stock? Systems biologists, who's, you know, does this gene actually upregulate or downregulate? Someone studying atmospheric science, trying to predict the weather. These are totally different domains, but there is something generic that perhaps they are all doing that is shared. So one person asked after the first keynote today, oh, could you have some way to categorize questions? Yes, yes, you could. Task taxonomies are completely critical. They're underlying a lot of the work in visualization. I'm calling operations the generic word for task. So things like sorting, filtering, browsing, comparing, finding trends, characterizing distributions and correlations. There have been a lot of taxonomies starting with Kasner going on. There's a very good one by Amar and Stasko. So there are taxonomies of tasks. And then back to those taxonomies of data, you have to ask, well, what type of data do I have? And remember that example about the cluster in the calendar. Sometimes that's not the data you're given. Most of the time, you don't get the data in the form you really need to draw the pictures of. You have to do the right transformation so the thing you draw the pictures of actually helps your user. And that might be a very different thing than the data file they handed you at the beginning of the collaboration. So a way to validate here is deploy it and actually see what happens. So try to understand, after you've built the tool, does it help them? The level we talked about a lot today is the visual encodings in terms of the drawing and the interaction of how they manipulate those drawings. So there's a lot of ways to validate this. A lot of what we talked about is known principles, so validating that you actually didn't violate anything that's known to be the case. But you typically have to build it and then see. So after you've built it, you want to actually look at your results, either quantitatively or more qualitatively, to see whether or not what you did is better than what someone else proposed. Or this is the place, those of you who heard Chris North's talk last year about usability, this is where you want to do lab studies, where you actually put humans down, you measure the time and error it takes them to complete some task that you give them, to try to understand, did your visual encoding and interaction choices actually work out? Now, there is one more level. Luckily, computer science can help here. So that's, I've got a spec, I've got to make myself an automatic algorithm. So we know from CS that before we even build the system, we could do a complexity analysis. And after it, we can run benchmarks and get timing results. So the key thing is you've got to match these things up. So for example, if you propose a new visual encoding and you try to validate by showing me system timings, I don't care. That is not the right level at which you want to validate a visual encoding. Or more subtly, if you want to validate the abstraction, you can't actually show that with a lab study, because in a lab study, you have provided the task for the user, and you're trying to validate whether or not you actually got that task right. So to recap, I talked about six visual encoding principles, about this idea that channels actually have types and rankings. There's hard constraints on how many colors you can use at once for categorical data, the power of spatial position on the plane, the danger of 3D depth, why it is that resolution would beat immersion, and why eyes would beat memory. And then finally, leaping back a level and talking about the levels of design, make sure that when you validate your methods, you're validating against the right thread. So there's more about this. If you want, for example, some of the references, more depth about the principles, and also the entire world of techniques, which would be a whole other talk, I've got a book chapter that tries to summarize this, lots of other papers and videos. And finally, if you don't want to copy down a lot of URLs, just write down that one. All right, thank you.